Well, Dr. Pappas, thank you very much for taking time today to educate your patients. I'm sure a lot of patients there need it either for themselves or some people need this information to take care of their loved ones. The first question, you know, you as one of the experts in the treatment of pelvic congestion in the country, how did you first get interested in this field?
So my background is I'm a vascular surgeon. And when I started my fellowship, my area of academic interest was always in venous disease. So I actually had an NIH grant in which I was studying venous ulcers. And from there, my whole career has kind of focused around patients who have problems with their veins. So lower leg veins, pelvic veins are all connected. So it's all part of the field of venous insufficiency.
And how is your approach to these patients different? You know, you having performed so many of these procedures over the years, I'm sure the way you treat these patients would have evolved. And compared to somebody else who may treat three of these patients a year, how is your approach different?
So I think the main difference, especially with women who have pelvic venous disorders, is one of awareness and education. My experience has been that most women who suffer from these problems don't make the connection between their symptoms and what's going on in their veins. They've been told that this is normal, that they just have to live with it, and they've never really been educated that this is correctable. So that's from the patient's point of view. From the physician's point of view, many of our OBGYN colleagues have been taught that this condition really doesn't exist. And even if you look at their literature today, they say there's really insufficient evidence to connect problems with their veins with their pelvic pain. I think part of the problem is one of definition. So when we go and we speak to our OBGYN colleagues about this and show them some of our own research from CBM, they start to understand that, you know what, maybe there are alternative treatments for these patients because beforehand they've just been turning them away and saying there's really nothing we can do for them. And I think that's been my biggest challenge, is educating referring physicians that there is treatment options that are very effective and durable.
So when you talk about effective and durable treatment options, what are those options and how durable are they?
So one of the things that's been most gratifying is that in part of CVM is that we are very self-reflective. We look back at our data and we analyze our results, and then we change our treatment patterns based upon what we found. So one of the things that we found is that the predominant theory that pelvic venous disorders are due to ovarian vein reflux is really not correct. A very small percentage of women, maybe between 7 to 15%, their pelvic pain is due to isolated ovarian disease. What we found when we looked at our data is that 80% of pelvic venous disorders are due to a blockage in the iliac vein, which is eminently treatable with a stent. Now, when most people hear stents, they're thinking about coronary stents or stents maybe in the legs that stay open maybe 3 years, 5 years at best. Venous stents are different. They stay open 10, 15, maybe even 20 years. And so in terms of long-term durability, that's huge in the stenting world. So what the hurdle that we have to kind of get over with the patients is to let them know that, you know, a stent is a permanent implant that can't be removed. But the good news is that for the majority of people, it stays open for many, many years, you know, decades. And that there are ways that you can re-intervene if you have to, if they're failing for some reason. So durability is great, 10, 15 years. Effectiveness, our data shows that, you know, over 80% of women do fine just with a stenting procedure alone. And those women who still may have some residual, they may need for a second procedure to embolize any residual disease in their pelvis. And then finally, the third thing I tell patients is that over 55% of women who present with pelvic congestion syndrome actually come to our offices because of lower extremity varicose veins. And they don't realize the relationship between their varicose veins and what's going on in their pelvis. And that's how we kind of find a lot of these women, because we start asking them very specific history questions, which they don't realize are related to what's going on in their legs.
So one of the key things you mentioned is that the lower extremity veins, what other symptoms would you say that if a patient is suffering from these symptoms, they should seek care of a specialist like yourself?
So like we said, over 55% of women present with varicose veins. The other thing that happens is many women have lower extremity pain and swelling. And when we do their ultrasounds, they're normal. So that's usually a tip off to look higher up, because when we perform an ultrasound, it's typically from the groin down, and we don't necessarily routinely look in the abdomen. Some of the history questions that we routinely ask women are ones related to intimacy. So it requires a little bit of tact when you have these discussions. So, you know, we ask them, do you have pain with vaginal intercourse? Do you have pain after vaginal intercourse? Do you have particularly painful periods? Are you avoiding intimacy for fear of pain when you have intimacy with your spouse? Do you have chronic feeling of bloating that if you stand for long periods of time, you feel heaviness in your pelvis? Do you have varices in your vulva, or did you have varices in your vulva during your pregnancies that may have gone away? Do you have varices that didn't go away? So these are some of the questions that we ask our patients to kind of hone us in on to whether or not they may have a pelvic venous disorder. Most of these questions, if the patients say yes, in my experience, have been 90-95% sensitive for there being a lesion that we find that we can correct.